This is the Ethnicity and Dementia online course with focus on Hmong Americans. My name is Linda Gerdner. I have worked with and conducted research in the Hmong American community for the past 15 years. To deepen my understanding of this ethnic minority, I traveled to northeastern Laos with a Hmong American friend where we focused our time visiting rural Hmong villages to learn more about their daily life. I've even been the recipient of a number of healing rituals, including a shamanic healing ceremony. The Hmong woman pictured here was born in Laos, but was forced to flee her homeland following the communist takeover of Laos in 1975. She is shown at Ban Vanai refugee camp in Thailand. Soon, she would be traveling to the United States to begin her life anew. In the 1960s, the war in Vietnam covertly spread into northeastern Laos, the geographic area where a fairly large number of Hmong people lived. Hmong men and boys were recruited by the Pathet Lao Communist on one side, and the Royal Lao Army with support from the United States Central Intelligence Agency on the other side. Those Hmong who supported the anti-communist effort under the leadership of General Vang Pao were stationed at Long Chen, an army base in the secluded highlands of Laos. They assisted the U.S. effort by monitoring the Ho Chi Minh Trail, gathering intelligence information for the CIA, and rescuing U.S. pilots who had been shot down by the communists. Following the communist takeover of Laos in 1975, the Hmong who assisted the United States were forced to flee their homeland or suffer persecution and death. The majority traveled on foot through the jungles of Laos and across the treacherous Mekong River to refugee camps in Thailand. They lived a tenuous existence in refugee camps until they were able to relocate to a host country such as the United States. Hmong people began arriving in the United States in 1975. Here is a map to show the geographic relationship between Vietnam, Laos, and Thailand. The blue line bordering the western portion of Laos is the Mekong River. The 2010 U.S. Census reported Hmong Americans living in 50 states plus the District of Columbia and Puerto Rico. The Hmong people constitute a growing number of our society. Traditionally, they have large families. In 2010, 41.8% of Hmong Americans were reported to be foreign-born. In Laos, few if any Hmong had access to education. This is reflected in the statistic that 84.4% of Hmong Americans have less than a ninth grade education. Persons over 65 years of age constitute a small percentage of the population, with the majority speaking Hmong as their sole language. California has the largest population of Hmong Americans. Elders usually live in the home of either their eldest or youngest son. The Hmong language has two dialects, either White Hmong or Green Hmong. Those speaking the White Hmong dialect are usually able to understand the Green Hmong dialect, but the reverse is not generally true. When possible, it is ideal to develop teaching materials in both dialects, but if not, the White Hmong dialect is generally preferred. Families are organized into an 18-clan structure. Membership into a clan is initially achieved through birth. Hmong people practice exogamy, requiring persons to marry outside of their own clan. Upon marriage, a woman leaves her clan and joins the clan of her husband. Traditionally, families are patriarchal, with members having well-defined roles and responsibilities. Interdependence is a core cultural value. Families recognize that anything affecting one family member will have a direct or indirect impact on all. It is for this reason that decisions are traditionally made as a group under the leadership of the eldest male. a clan leader is only consulted when there is an unresolved dispute. Traditionally, spiritual beliefs are closely interwoven with perception of health and illness and are critical to spiritual well-being. By tradition, the Hmong people practice a combination of animism and ancestor worship. Within the belief system of animism, each person is born with multiple souls. The exact number may differ by informant, but usually it is agreed that there are three primary souls. These souls must remain in harmony to achieve and maintain health. Spiritual illness occurs when one or more of these souls become separated from the human body. It is believed that the environment is comprised of natural entities and that each entity has a spirit. Natural entities include trees, rocks, and bodies of water. The spirits of these entities may have either a benevolent, malevolent, or a neutral effect on human souls. Those with a negative impact may disrupt the person's spiritual harmony. Ancestor worship is also an important aspect of the traditional spiritual beliefs of Hmong people. They believe there is a strong interrelationship between the physical world of the living and the spiritual world inhabited by deceased family members. This is a reciprocating relationship. Spiritual harm may result if the reciprocating nature of this relationship is violated. When spiritual imbalance is suspected, a shaman is consulted. The shaman has the unique ability to travel to the spirit world to determine the cause of the problem and determine how best to rectify the problem. Some illnesses, particularly those that are less severe and non-life-threatening, may have a biological cause requiring treatment with herbs and organic substances such as dried animal parts. These remedies may be used alone or in combination with spiritual healing. Overall, a trial-and-error approach plays an important role in determining the cause. However, depression and cognitive impairment are often seen as having a spiritual cause. In Laos, the Hmong people are dependent on traditional healers such as shamans and herbalists to treat illness. It must be emphasized that Hmong Americans are a heterogeneous people as determined by individual spiritual beliefs, level of education, ability to speak English, their country of birth, and degree of acculturation. Generalities should not be made. Each person must be assessed on an individual basis. Confusion and memory impairment are not new concepts to Hmong Americans. The Hmong have a word that is used to describe someone with these problems. They have a proverb that addresses this issue. The proverb compares an elder who has memory impairment with a tree that has been hollowed with age. However, there's no word in the Hmong language that directly translates to the word dementia. Anyone interested in learning more about the traditional views regarding the cause and treatment of memory impairment and confusion in elders in Laotian Hmong are encouraged to refer to the citation on the screen. A Hmong woman was even featured on the cover of this journal. Just to pique your curiosity, this article includes a story cloth that features a Hmong woman living in Laos who has confusion and memory problems. Shaman Xiong served as the expert who relayed the story to his artistic son. The cloth was then embroidered by his wife. Although there are no statistics on the prevalence of dementia in the Hmong American population, it is an important issue.
Unless you speak Hmong fluently and understand the language well, you will not be able to appropriately and adequately assess and treat Hmong older patients. Also, given the complexity of the medical language, it is vitally important that you use a competent and qualified Hmong healthcare interpreter and not a family member to conduct your assessment and provide your treatment. At the same time, because of sensitive and private information not being shared, out of respect for the patient's family, patient himself and herself, and the person interpreting, just don't use family members. Lastly, in my own personal experience, live person interpretation is preferred over telephone line interpretation because of their high context language communication versus low context language communication, like with most Western language. The following are key factors when assessing and treating Hmong American clients. Acculturation. You will find it easier to work with younger and educated Hmong Americans than you would with older Hmong Americans who have less formal education and with little or no experiences with mainstream culture. Also, specific experiences with Western medicine, regardless of education and generation, has better outcomes when working with Western doctors. Another factors are their cultural beliefs and practices. These play a key role in patients' behavior and reaction toward Western medicine. Most of the elders see the primary cause of illness as not physical cause, but spiritual. Therefore, you may be their second or third choices of care. Also, they have viewed Western medicine as, quote, experimental, unquote, with no guaranteeing of, quote, cure, unquote. So a traditional Hmong adult male patient and his family members are where you will most likely have issue of noncompliance with treatment plan and resistance to having certain invasive procedures done. And with regard to mental health illnesses, Hmong usually perceive these problems as negative stigma. Family do not talk about them. And other Hmong people often avoid the person and sometimes the family altogether, specifically with dementia. If it occurs at a younger age, more likely this will bring on more negative stigma. But if dementia happened during old age, then it is not. We recommend following the National Institute on Aging for a quick assessment of cognitive impairment in older adults. Health assessment must be done on an individual basis. With Hmong elders, the individual assessment must be done through a qualified and trained healthcare interpreter and with the family member that is most knowledgeable about the patient's health and disease process. And be open-minded, as you will not get a straight answer to the questions you ask. Sometimes the answers are intertwined in story, and the answers may lead you to refer to alternative healers as part of your treatment plan. At the present time, most of the cognitive assessment tools are unreliable and invalid, as they have not been normed for this particular population. The goal of these quick assessments are for primary care providers to screen and monitor for cognitive impairment in their patient. At the present time, none of these cognitive assessments are linguistically and culturally appropriate for assessing cognitive impairment in Hmong American elders, as they have been shown or can be seen to have adversely influenced by education, age, language, and verbal ability of the Hmong patient. But Johnson has demonstrated that both the MMSE and mini cognitive or mini cog are best for primary care to use as assessment of cognitive impairment, with mini cog being not adversely influenced by education, age, language, and verbal ability. Given that all of the cognitive assessments will have validity and reliability issues with Hmong patients, even with the use of an interpreter, the bigger issue lies with the patient's lacking formal education, experiences with Western medicine, and high illiteracy rate. These above factors will significantly affect how they perform on these cognitive assessments. Therefore, we recommend adapting the orientation and fund of knowledge in the assessment portions of the instrument, as well as the contents that reflect immediate and long-term memory portions of the instrument. The contents of these items should be objects or entities that are commonly seen or experienced in the Hmong community. And with the above recommendation, we recommend that MiniCog has a potential instrument for assessing this population. Furthermore, the drawing of a clock and the three words choice item appear to be culturally appropriate, as they may appear to be less susceptible to an influence of education, age, language, and verbal ability. Traditionally, the youngest son and daughter-in-law bear the responsibility of caring for their parents in older ages by default. Now, the new practice has been that the elder parents are choosing to live with the sons and or daughter-in-laws who cares more about the elderly parents and make them feel more appreciative. Also, depending on the severity of the patient's condition, it may be better for him or her to be cared for and stay at home with one of their children. Unless the patient's care requires more specialized attention, Hmong family will rarely take the elders into a nursing home or immediate care facility. With regards to health decision-making, within the family, that responsibility falls onto the elder son and daughter-in-law or younger son and daughter-in-law. They are the primary caretaker of their elderly parents. Other leaders and elders in the family will be the secondary option. Here was a clinical case that I had the opportunity to work on. This was an 80-year-old traditional Hmong male who is living with his children because his wife has left him. He was disabled, wheelchair-bounded for most of the day. He received SSI and had in-home supported services. He was depressed and did not want any outside help, but only his family. Clinically, I noted that he was quite forgetful. Specifically, he was not able to retain what I just said to him. He mainly just kept repeating back all information that he was able to remember. There was aphasia, agnosia, and apraxia noted in this elder. Due to his immobility, there was quite a decline in his social functioning and also in activities. I diagnosed him on axis 1 with senile dementia with depressive feature, and then on axis 3 with multiple chronic health problems such as diabetes, hypercholesterolemia, hard of hearing, and overweight, and then on axis 4 issues of acculturation, poverty, language barriers, and vision problem, and then with the GAF of 45. Given the patient's cognitive impairment, I work closely with the child that provided care for him and gather as much information as I can. At the same time, I ask the child to see if there are other elders that the patient associated with that could also provide any other information about his conditions and behavior. Those are to show respect and thus increase the rapport with the client and his caretaker as well. Regarding adaptive assessment, I asked whether he knows about the Leng, which is a traditional Hmong instrument that are used to play in a number of events, and I show it to him, and he said he does, but that he doesn't remember how to play it anymore. This is confirmed by his son's remark about his father slowly not remembering to do things. It is a practice that Hmong parents take care of their children when they are young, and the children will take care of their parents when they are old. Therefore, exploring best care options for children and other family members is key to making sure patients get the most appropriate care, even if that is not the best. Finally, it is important to collaborate with the patient's primary care provider, especially when there are physical illness present, like in this particular case. At the present time, there aren't many medications that have been approved for specifically treating dementia. Here's a list of the drug categories and medications that are commonly used to treat various symptoms associated with dementia. The ones highlighted in blue are medications noted to be most frequently prescribed for Hmong patients. Regarding medications with Hmong people, Over the many years that I've worked with medical providers and Hmong patients here in Fresno, two interesting myths seem to emerge consistently. First, with providers complaining that Hmong patients do not take their medications as directed. Second, with Hmong patients saying the medicine will worsen my condition. So what happens? Doctors will be prescribing different and more stronger medications, and patients carrying bags and bags of medications when they come to see me for psychological services. When working with Hmong patients, these are some important thoughts to consider. Make sure you only use qualified and competent healthcare interpreters. Do not use family members and any other Hmong interpreters, because healthcare language is a specialized language in itself. If you're going to use any kind of assessments, know that they may not be culturally and linguistically appropriate and valid for Hmong patients. Therefore, it might be best to work from a holistic perspective that includes family members, others in the culture, and the primary care provider. Finally, when working cross-culturally, your opinion of best care for the patient may not be as important as what's the most culturally appropriate for the patient. A nursing facility may be the best option, but the home of the patient's child may be culturally better.
This section of the presentation reports findings from the first ethnographic study to address how life in the United States has affected the perception and care of elder Hmong Americans with memory problems and confusion. The study was conducted in the St. Paul, Minneapolis metro area, which has the largest concentration of Hmong Americans living in the United States, and extended into Wisconsin. This slide provides demographic information on the informants for the study as well as the care recipients. Interviews were conducted with family caregivers, traditional healers, and community liaisons. The majority of interviews were conducted by the investigator with the assistance of a certified healthcare interpreter. The majority of caregivers labeled the elder's condition with the traditional Hmong term that was previously identified. Only 6 of the care recipients had actually received a medical diagnosis for this condition, with one informant adding, "But many of us do not know what this means," referring to the diagnostic term. The term dementia was perceived with a negative connotation. For example, one caregiver stated, "In America, they give this diagnosis to crazy people, but I don't think she's crazy. It's her memory. She doesn't remember what she's eaten. She doesn't remember what people have told her or what people have done for her. So her memory is not there." The perceived cause for the elder's condition varied by the informant. Shamans attributed the condition to soul loss. In comparison, a Hmong Christian minister said the person was unfulfilled emotionally. He elaborated by stating, "Their spiritual side is empty, so they have no hope for the future. The emotional affects the physical." Shamans elaborated by identifying 3 spiritual causes for memory problems and confusion. First, in the United States, many elders live in loneliness. They're getting sad and lonely, don't want to stay near the body, so that is why they wander around. In this example, the shaman was referring to the spirit wandering around. Second, it was believed that an evil spirit may invade or attach itself to the person's body. More specifically, one shaman said, "An evil spirit could block the elder's mind so that he or she doesn't know how to think clearly." And third, evil spirit takes the person's soul and tortures it, causing the person to become crazy and forgetful. Overall, family members identified aging as the cause of dementia. This is fairly consistent with the proverb that was previously presented. However, the majority of community liaisons attributed stress to the cause. This slide represents a married couple's responsibilities to family and clan, as depicted through concentric circles. primary responsibilities begin in the center and extend outward. So first, their first responsibility is to their nuclear family. From there, the couple's responsibilities extend to the husband's family, then the wife's family, and then extending outward, the responsibility is to the husband's clan. Because remember, the wife joins her husband's clan upon marriage. And finally, their responsibility is to the Hmong community as a whole. Now let's discuss the caregiving structure. The caregivers in this study said that the eldest son has the primary responsibility for his aging parents, with his wife providing the actual hands-on care. Conflicts with this tradition are emerging due to changing roles and lifestyles of the Hmong people living in America. Some persons outside of this study have argued that it is the youngest son who has the primary responsibility for his aging parents. It may be more accurate to say that in America it is either the youngest or the oldest son who is responsible for the care of his parents. The overwhelming majority of caregivers viewed their role as an honor in return for the love and care that had been given to them by the elder. Caregiving also served as a model of traditional values for younger generations. The caregiving role was much more difficult for women who had a career outside of the home. Regardless of the personal beliefs of the caregiver, traditional healers were sought when the elder retained beliefs of animism and ancestor worship. Shamanic healing ceremonies were used to promote spiritual well-being and family unity. The religious leader recommended that Christian Hmong seek spiritual assistance when initially confronted with memory impairment. However, since the majority of family members viewed the elder's condition as a normal part of aging, they did not seek treatment from a physician unless accompanied by a health crisis. With regard to support groups, a local chapter of the Alzheimer's Association was unsuccessful in initiating a support group in the Hmong American community. One community member was puzzled as to why a family would seek the assistance of strangers to discuss such a sensitive issue. This is consistent with the perspective of a caregiver who emphasized, "You need to talk it over with someone in the family. You have to keep it in the family." Overall, caregivers were selective about whom they chose to confide in regarding the elder's condition. Open-ended questions were also included to address access and use of nursing homes. At the time of the study, the geographic area had a few units that were advertised as specializing in the care of Asian Americans. However, family members identified the need for culturally responsive care. The following criteria were identified as essential and included Hmong-speaking staff, serve foods that are culturally appropriate, be located in close proximity to family to allow frequent visits, be welcoming to family members, allowing flexibility for residents to practice traditional ceremonies such as hupli, which is a soul calling ceremony, for those who retain animistic beliefs, and prayer ceremonies for those who are Christian. Family caregivers identified a critical need for teaching materials that were culturally sensitive. As an initial effort, I am the primary author of a picture book for Hmong American children and their families. The title is Grandfather's Story Cloth. General themes from the life experiences of Hmong American family caregivers provide the storyline for this bilingual illustrated book about a grandfather who has Alzheimer's disease and his grandson. The book introduces the idea of using a story cloth to stimulate grandfather's remote memory as a means of promoting communication and understanding between grandfather and grandson. The story clearly states that grandfather has been seen by a physician and has received a diagnosis of probable Alzheimer's disease. This slide shows an illustration from the book. This painting includes a discreet message that grandfather has also been treated by a shaman. Can you find the clue? If you look closely, an appliqué has been added or sewn to the back of grandfather's shirt. This was done during a shamanic healing ceremony in an effort to extend grandfather's mandate of life. With an increase in life expectancy, there is an increased risk for dementia. Caregiving of elders with dementia poses new challenges for the Hmong American community. Family/clan and spirituality are primary factors in determining care for these elders. The roles of family/clan members are well defined based on gender, generation, and kinship. Specific to this study, these roles define caregiving responsibilities of elders with dementia and extend outward to the use of community services. Spiritual orientation influences perceived cause and health-seeking behaviors. Study participants identified dementia as a neglected issue within the Hmong community. There is critical need to develop culturally and linguistically appropriate family caregiver training programs. The Hmong community rely heavily on family and clan for support and information. Outreach efforts should include these authority figures. Suggested research implications are listed on this slide and include: collaborate with Hmong American healthcare professionals for development of a linguistically and culturally responsive educational program for family caregivers. Seek endorsement from community leaders regarding this program. Select locations for presentation that are easily accessible and culturally meaningful. And one example might be the Hmong Cultural Center. Finally, design studies to assess knowledge pre- and post-test, as well as the strengths and weaknesses of the program.